Hello students, this is Dr. Neelu Srivastava, Assistant Professor in English, Government Digvijay Autonomous PG College, Rajnandgaon. Today we are going to take up Girish Kannad's famous play Hayavadhan, which is in the course of BA Final Paper 1. So let us start the play, but first we will take up Girish Kannad's introduction. So students, let us start with Girish Kannad's introduction. Girish Raghunath Kannad, his full name, is one of the notable playwrights of the contemporary Indian stage. He is not only a playwright but also a poet, an actor, director, critic, translator and cultural administrator as well. He belongs to a generation that has produced Dharmveer Bharti, Mohan Rakesh and Vijay Tendulkar, who have created a national theatre for the modern India. Still, the most famous field of Girish Kannad has been as a playwright. His plays written in Kannada have been widely translated into English and all major Indian languages too. Kannad's plays are written neither in English except few, in which he dreamt of earning international literary fame, nor in his mother tongue Konkani. Instead, they are composed in his adopted language Kannad, which later he has translated into English too. Girish Kannad is one of the most influential playwrights of our time, and his plays have become a byword for imagination, innovation and craftsmanship. Kannad has been honored with many literary awards, and some of them are: he got Padma Bhushan in 1992, Gyanpeeth Award in 1998, Sangeet Natak Academy Award 1972, State Award for his play Ayati, National Film Award for Best Direction in 1972, Kalidas Samman for Theatre, then Kamala Devi Award for Hayavadhan in 1971. Basically, Kannad belongs to the Kannad theatre, and his plays are characterized by myths, legends, folk tales, histories, not only for the literary purposes but also to portray the contemporary situations. Girish Kannad had a long, eventful career as a playwright. His first play, Yayati, was brought out in 1961. After 3 years came his next most significant play, Tughlaq, in 1964. Then in 1975, Hayavadhan was published. On the same year, he published another play, Anju Maligi. Thereafter, a silence of almost a decade, in 1980, he brought out another play, Hittina Hunja, and in 1987 he produced Nagamandala. Girish Kannad was a man other than a dramatist as well. Besides writing plays, Kannad has also written scripts for films and acted in them too. In 1970 he wrote the script of the film Samskara and acted in it too. In 1971, he directed the film Vansha Vriksha in the company of V.B. Karand, in which he acted too. He has directed many other films too. Some of them are Kadu in 1973, Tabalya, Ninade Megane in 1971, Ondma Nondu Kohadali in 1978 and Utsav in 1984. So students, Hayavadhan, which we are going to study today in detail, it was his third successful play and which came to publication in 1975. Hayavadhan is a memorable treatment of the theme of the search for completeness. The main plot of the play is a judicious blend of folk tales from Somadva's Katha Sarit Sagra and the story of the transpose heads by a German dramatist Thomas Mann. The subject plot of the play, The Horse Head Man, is Karnad's own invention. It serves both as a prologue and epilogue of the play. The storyline of the play goes like this. Devdatta, a scholarly young man, and Kapila, a sturdy man, are intimate friends. Devdatta is fair in color, unrivaled in intelligence, whereas Kapila is the only son of Lohita, the ironsmith in the armory of the king. Although Kapila is dark complexioned and plain to look at, yet his physique is unrivaled. They are very close friends, but their relations get complicated when Devdatta marries Padmini. One day, they plan for a short visit to Ujjain. Kapila drives the cart. Padmini admires Kapila's physique and his art of driving the cart. But Devdatta does not like it at all. Kapila offers to go to the temple of Rudra, and Padmini also agrees to go with him. Devdatta does not go with them and stays back because he feels jealous of Kapila. He asks Kapila to take his wife to the temple of Rudra. So Padmini and Kapila go to the Rudra temple. In the meantime, Devdatta moves towards the temple of Kali. Before his marriage to Padmini, he had vowed that if he would get married to Padmini, he would sacrifice his head to Rudra and his limbs to Kali. Now he is reminded of his vow. So he finds a sword in the temple of Kali and kills himself. Soon Padmini and Kapila return from the visit to Rudra temple. Kapila finds Devdatta's footprints leading to the direction of temple of Kali. He goes there and finds his friend lying in a pool of blood. Kapila says that he cannot live without Devdatta and kills himself there with the sword. After some time, Padmini also reaches the temple of Kali. She is shocked to see both of them dead there. She feels that if she returns home alone, people would feel that the true friends fought and died for her and she would be despised. So she also takes up the sword to kill herself. But then goddess Kali appears there and asks her not to commit suicide. Padmini asks goddess Kali as to why she did not stop both Devdatta and Kapila from committing suicide. Kali said that both of them were lying till the end, and it is only Padmini who spoke the truth, that she could not show her face to anyone after death of two friends. Then goddess Kali asked her to rejoin the heads of the two dead people, and after that they will be alive again. Padmini gets very excited and she puts the wrong heads on the bodies in excitement. Gradually both the bodies get alive and they start moving here and there. They sit up slowly and stiffly, but Padmini realizes that she had attached wrong heads to the wrong bodies, and she prays to goddess, "What have I done? Only you can save me now from what I have done." Goddess Kali says nothing, and she does not come to help Padmini. Now the two friends start arguments over who is the husband of Padmini. The person with Devdatta head says that Padmini is his wife, as according to Shastras, the head is the sign of man. At this, Kapila says that these are the hands that accepted her at the wedding, and the child she is carrying is the seed of this body. So he is the husband of Padmini. Devdatta says that when one accepts a partner in marriage, one accepts the person, not the body. So she did not marry Devdatta's body, but Devdatta the person. So Padmini should go with him. Now Devdatta and Padmini halt there as they feel that their problem should be resolved before they move away to the city. Then Padmini says that it was she who gave Kapila life, so what she says should be finally carried out. This act comes to an end with it, and the second act begins with the next part. Here Devdatta, Kapila and Padmini go to a great rishi regarding what they should do. The rishi gives the verdict: as the heavenly Kalpa Vraksha is supreme among tree, so is the head among human limbs. Therefore the man with the Devdatta's head is indeed Devdatta, and he is the husband of Padmini. So Devdatta and Padmini, they become very happy, and Kapila becomes very sad and goes to the forest. But gradually Devdatta loses the body strength of Kapila and becomes a Brahman. Again, and Kapila loses the weak body of Devdatta and becomes a strong personality again. Over the time, Devdatta's body reverts to how it used to be, and he and Padmini start to fight a lot over the best way to raise their son. Padmini starts thinking of Kapila again and again. She takes her son to show the forest for the first time, and she finds Kapila living there. As Devdatta has lost physical strength over time, so has Kapila regained his back. He accepts that he is fully Kapila now. Padmini stays in the forest for several nights with Kapila. When Devdatta finds them together, he is distraught, and the man decides to kill each other to end the rivalry forever. After they are dead, Padmini throws herself upon the funeral pyre. The tragedy is offset by a man who comes on a stage telling of a horse walking down the street singing a national anthem. Another actor joins him on the stage with a crying child who is Padmini and Devdatta's son. Hayavadana's returns to the stage and tells how he asks Kali to make him complete. So a new character named as Hayavadan comes on the stage, and here is the story of Hayavadan. Hayavadan's mother was the princess of Karnataka, and out of love she married a stallion, that is a male horse. She lived with him happily for 15 years with perfect love, but after 15 years that stallion turns into a beautiful Gandharva. As he was released of a curse given by God to him, now he decides to go back to heaven and asks his wife to go with him. She agrees to go but wants him to take the shape of horse again. He gets away and curses her to become a mare, and he went away. She becomes a mare and gives birth to a child with a head of horse. In this way, Hayavadan was born. Now, Hayavadan, the child, wishes to get rid of his horse head. He visits many places and finally comes to Kali temple. He threatens Kali Ma to chop his head if his wish is not fulfilled. Then goddess Kali makes him a complete horse but not a complete man, but he retains a human voice. It is only when a 5-year-old son of Padmini makes him laugh again that his laughter turns into a proper name. This completeness is the main theme of the play Hayavadan. So, Hayavadan tells his story, and Padmini's son likes him very much, and the two sing and laugh together. Hayavadan wishes that his voice was not human, and Padmini's son tells him to laugh. As he does so, the laugh becomes less like that of a man and more like the whinnying of a horse. And here the play ends with the narrator heralding the mercy of Lord Ganesha, who has granted the Hayavadan and Padmini's son what they want. He begins to pray and is joined in it by other characters as well. So we see that the play Hayavadan has various themes which Girish Karnad has dealt with. So let us just talk about different themes which Karnad has dealt with in this play. We can say that there are three main themes Karnad has taken up in this play. The first theme is of hybridity. One of the themes of the play is that of creatures that are hybrids of different things. For example, the title character Hayavadan is a hybrid of man and horse. Devdatta and Kapila, they also with the passage of time become hybrids of each other because their heads get transferred from one body to another. They are transposed. And at the opening of the play, the prayer is offered to Lord Ganesha, who is also a god with the head of an elephant. So he is worshipped as the lord and master of perfection, which is paradoxical so far as his appearance is concerned. So as the play continues, the hybrid characters seem less and less perfect to themselves, and all ultimately feel that they are incomplete because they are not fully one creature or another creature. The second theme which has been dealt in the play is that of incompleteness. The theme of incompleteness is personified by all the characters. First of all, Devdatta finds himself incomplete as he is intellectually very wise but physically very weak. Similarly, Kapila feels himself incomplete because he is physically very strong but intellectually low. Thirdly, Padmini feels himself incomplete because she chooses Devdatta as her husband but longs for the physicality of Kapila. She feels incomplete because she has been abandoned twice by these two men, which make her realize her incompleteness. Devdatta and Kapila feel incomplete as they have each other's head joined to their bodies. Both begin to feel incomplete as soon as the switch has as soon as the switch has occurred. They feel that they are living half existences. The most obvious example of incompleteness is Hayavadan, who wants nothing more than to be made complete. He wishes to be a complete man, but Kali makes him a complete horse instead. Even after that, he feels incomplete because he still has the voice of man. When he is able to change this and achieve neigh of horse instead, he finally feels himself complete. The third theme which Karnad has taken up in the play is that of theme of conflict. So one of the conflict in the play is that of head and heart. It is between head and heart, they don't go together. The head thinks what is right, but the heart does what it wants. Although Padmini is initially attracted to Devdatta's mind, she realizes that she is physically attracted to Kapila, and it is this desire that is ultimately much harder for her to overcome. Another conflict found in the play is reflected between logic and the lust. Although initially the head wins, personified by Devdatta, but eventually the body demonstrates, personified by Kapila. Logically, Padmini loves Devdatta as he is intelligent and well off, and therefore she marries him, but her body demands Kapila's muscular body out of her physical desires. That is the reason that she is extremely happy when accidentally she joins Devdatta's head with Kapila's body. She goes immediately with this new man of her choice. Ultimately, as they are unable to reconcile their contrast, the two men kill each other and Padmini kills herself also, proving that when these two sides of human being are not in agreement, the consequences get very tragic. Now let us have a look on the main characters of the play. The play normally deals with three main characters, that is Devdatta, Kapila and Padmini. Devdatta, the hero of the play, is undoubtedly handsome and comely in appearance. He is fair in color and magnificent in aspects, but he is also unrivaled in wit and intelligence. He is the only son of Reverend Brahman Vidyasagar of Dharmapura. In debates and logic, he has showed his power and donned the mightiest of pundits. In poetry writing, he he has humiliated the greatest of poets. He is the apple of everyone's eye in Dharmapura. Then he is a great friend of Kapila, who is opposite to him in almost every aspect, but is still he is very close to him, and in almost every sense they are so opposite to each other, but still they maintain their friendship. Devdatta is a born lover, and when we meet him at the beginning of the play, Kapila tells us that he has already been in love for 15 times. Every time he has fallen in love with a girl unrivaled in beauty, but as the play opens, we find him falling in love with Padmini, the only daughter of a merchant who lived in Pavan Vithi of Dharmapura. Then Devdatta is a jealous husband too. He is deeply in love with Padmini but can brook no rival. When he finds that Kapila is also in love with her and that she too has a soft corner for him in her heart, he decides to commit suicide. but in the process he is saved. However, his head is implanted on the body of Kapila and the head of Kapila is implanted on his body. This change is able to provide Padmini immense satisfaction because now she has intelligence of Devdatta and the physical prowess of Kapila. Gradually, the body of Kapila begins to grow listless and loses its potency. Then Devdatta and Kapila again meet. They fight against each other and they both are killed. But before his death, Devdatta appears before Kapila with his sword in his head and challenges Kapila for a fight. He tells Kapila, no grounds for friendship now, no question of mercy. We must fight like lions and kill like cobras. He, through his experience of living with Kapila's body, has learned that the talk about generosity, mercy and friendship which he hid his subconscious motives earlier is now meaningless. So this is the character of Devdatta, the hero of the play. Then Kapila is a great friend of Devdatta, and from the very beginning they are contrasted with each other. Kapila is black complexioned and he is unrivaled in physical prowess. And if Devdatta is a born lover, Kapila is also a lover. When he goes to search the house of Padmini and when he meets her, we find him almost falling in love with Padmini. He praises the choice of Devdatta very much. So he is a great lover as well. And although Devdatta and Kapila are very close and intimate friends, yet Padmini creates difficulties in the smooth passage of their friendship. Padmini is fascinated by both of them and this creates the problem. This fascination on the face of it is unacceptable to Indian society. What complicates the matter further is that Kapila is of lower caste Hindu while Devdatta is a Brahmin. As such, the union of these three like Draupadi and Pandava would be still less acceptable to the society. Since life for Kapila is meaningless without Padmini, the only alternate before him is death. Thus, Karnad suggests that there is the need of a society which will accept a woman who is in love with two men at the same time. Now, let us have a look at the character of Padmini. Padmini is undoubtedly the heroine of the play and she is extremely beautiful. When Kapila reaches her home, searching for her only the indication of the door, she meets him on the door. She asks Kapila if he is all right in the head and in the eyes. But Kapila is actually infatuated to see the beauty of Padmini. And very soon she is married to Devdatta. Although she accepts Devdatta as her husband, she is not prepared to yield her fascination for Kapila. So she is not a faithful wife. She wants the intelligence of Devdatta also, but at the same time she wants the physique of Kapila also. So Padmini is a delicate bridge between the earth and the sky. And when Devdatta reconciles himself to have the body of Kapila, and when Devdatta and Kapila go away, she comes to Kapila and tries to cheer him up by saying that he would be happy that she is going with his body. While she asks Devdatta to take her where the earth is soft and the green grass plays the swing, she exclaims, "My Devdatta comes like a bridegroom with the ornament of a new baby," which is that of Kapila. So we see that Padmini, she wants anything which is good for her in her life. And after the death of Devdatta and Kapila, Padmini prepares to perform sati. The very idea of sati is ridiculed here, but her death makes her assert her will. Social norms would not allow her to assert her will while she is living, so she prefers death. As she dies, she says to the Bhagavad Gita, "My son is sleeping in the hut. Take him under your care. Give him to the hunters who live in the forest and tell them it is Kapila's son. They loved Kapila and would bring up the child. Let the child grow in the forest with the rivers and trees. When he is 5, take him to the reverend Brahmin Vidyasagara of Dharampura. Tell him it is Devdatta's son." This fusion of the two is what Padmini wanted in her own person. Since she cannot do so, hence she decides that her need should be fulfilled in her son. Thus, we see that Karnad has presented the theme of incompleteness at three levels: divine, human, and animal. Bhagavata regards Ganesha incomplete because he has the elephant head and the human body, but at the end of the play, he praises Ganesha as he fulfills the desire of all: a grandson to grandfather, a smile to a child, a neigh to a horse. In case of Devdatta, Kapila and Padmini, we see that they fail to achieve completeness. They all die, but Hayavadan achieves completeness alone. He wanted to become a man, but he becomes at least complete horse. So the theme of incompleteness has been nicely presented in this play by Girish Karnad. Thank you so much. We will meet in another lecture soon. So I hope, students, that you would have been able to understand the play in a better way. You must have got an idea about the story, techniques, themes and characters of the play, and you will be in a position to appreciate Girish Karnad's famous play in a better way. We will meet in another lecture soon. Till then, goodbye.